One. You are live, you are live.
Good morning to the sunrise fairy. Oh, spider webs everywhere. Welcome, my name is Brent Leo Smith. I have Jandre on camera. We have Jamie and VM out in the other vehicle, and we have Geraldine and Louise in final control. And it is setting up to be an absolutely spectacular morning. The clouds rolling past the eastern horizon at the moment. I'm in the area where we had shadows stalking Impala last night. And the Impala is still there, so maybe she gave up. Jamie is checking for Karula. And we are hoping for leopards all over the place this morning. Now, it is a particularly chilly morning for me, even though it is only 20 degrees Celsius, which is, I think, 78 Fahrenheit. But I've already started getting ready for winter, thinking about finding my gloves and such and such. But it is going to be a beautiful morning. And we're going to just do a big loop while it's dark around Impala Plains, Impala Road. And once it gets light, we're going to check our western boundary, see if Shadow might have managed to sneak across there. I haven't seen any tracks yet, so it's possible she's still in this block to the east of us here. So, fingers crossed. I definitely want to have a good look at Shadow, see if we can see definite suckle marks. All right. Call me a pessimist, but until I see suckle marks or I see a cub, I don't believe. So it'll be interesting to see if we can find her this morning. Now, the one joy about a spotlight, it's like a mobile heater. Maybe I should hold my hands on it like this and drive with my legs. This road we're on now is pretty much the boundary between Shadow and her mom, Karula. So it could be either a leopard in this area. Now there, Karula we know has cubs. Shadow, there's been reports of cubs so far and she's behaving like she's got cubs. But until we can see definite suckle marks or a cub itself, I am going to on the side of caution, as anywhere rumors can fly and burn through an area at the speed incomparable, like a hurricane through the Sabi sands when it comes to rumors of lion and leopard cubs. So I, as I said, I'd rather be a little bit pessimistic and wait till I can confirm myself. Now, it did look like Shadow had a wound on her stomach. And I'd also like to see that and check on it. Well, we have a comment from one of our new viewers, a new member to the Safari Live family. Is that what I think it is, Jandre? Can you see that there? I think I found, is it? It is. Stand by, guys. I'm just gonna put this spotlight somewhere in the general area. Balance it while I go double check. Make sure I'm not fibbing to you. So let's go have a look what that is. And hopefully it's something I can bring closer to show you. Sad face. It is something, but it's not something I'm going to disturb. I initially thought it might be a really small chameleon, but it's not. It's an African vagrant butterfly that's sleeping there, and they do sometimes confuse us and look a little bit like chameleons, but not this case. So we're going to find my ears. Oh, I think I've got my ears now. And there's the moon that is setting at the moment. But I've got my ears now, so we're going to carry on. See if we can find any track or sign of this female leopard. So, let's check carefully here. Aaron in New Zealand would like to know whether I'm going to try to find the side-striped jackals today. Ooh, Aaron, I'm not sure yet. Let's see what's happening on Juma first, and then maybe we will head off towards the southern edge of the Arethusa airstrip. They might be there, or they might have moved off. You never know. So I think I'm going to concentrate on leopard for now, but if we don't find any leopard, we definitely might take a little meander down towards the southern end of the Arethusa airstrip. So while we continue to search for shadow, let's go see what Jamie's up to.
Good morning and welcome to the Sunrise Safari. As Brent has already updated you, we will be searching not necessarily for Karula herself, but just my aim of this morning is to try and figure out where exactly she's decided to den. So last night, when we had her, she was quite full-bellied, in my opinion. It was a very brief sighting, and it was a very tricky sighting because she kept moving through the bushes. But I'm fairly certain that she had quite a full belly. And when she walked past an entire herd of impala and I switched off all my lights, my impression was that her interest in them was almost academic. So in other words, being the opportunist that leopards are, and I don't think she was actually interested from a I'm hungry kind of point of view. I think she was moving through the area, and I want to see if I can figure out, not necessarily to find her, although that would be an ideal bonus, but just to figure out where she's keeping those cubs now, because to be completely honest, we have what we think is a rough idea, but we really don't know. And it would be nice to know, just in terms of whenever we go tracking anything, whenever we go for a walk in a drainage line, and where to avoid with our vehicles. Just so that we've got a... Oh, I forgot about this patch of road. Vuba Road is no more where Vuba Road used to be. The elephants have seen to that. They've quite casually created a pan in the middle of the road. Sandra, me too. I also really hope that we see those leopards again. Sandra's watching on YouTube. That was such an amazing coincidence that Brent and myself found two leopards within what it must have been about the space of 30 seconds, 45 seconds of each other. That being said, I think that yesterday morning, Karula watched me drive past her three times, maybe four times. I spent the whole afternoon trying to figure out exactly where she'd gone off the road. And I think I picked the wrong direction, or the wrong side of the road. And I'm positive she watched Dave and myself drive past. The thing is, after all this rain, vegetation is so dense that you can barely see more than 10 meters into the bush. Not that we're complaining, because it is wonderful to see. It's not going to last for very long, but it is wonderful to see for now. But it does make tracking leopards somewhat tricky. I'm just going to stop for one moment. We can have a look at the sky for now. Isn't that the most extraordinary light you've seen in a while? We've had so many special sunrises and sunsets recently. I just wanted to listen to the guinea fowl calling. But they are not alarm calling, they're just doing their general morning call.
Hold on a moment. Earpiece out. There are lions calling very, very far away. I can hear them off to the south. Oof, bird noise is positively deafening. That's maybe not the best description, but get rid of the spider web that was on the camera. So noisy this morning. Okay. Can pop my earpiece back in. I just wanted to try and figure out exactly how far away those leopard calls, or sorry, those lion calls were. But going back to the subject of leopards, Aqua would like to know, who is bigger, Mvula or the Anderson male? Aqua, I've never seen the Anderson male, but I have heard that he is one of the biggest leopards that has ever graced the property of the Sabi Sands. Close to, if not more than, I'm going off what Brent and James and Scott and the other guides have said about him, that he is close, well over 100 kilograms after a good meal, which puts him over 200 plus pounds. So he is most definitely the larger of the two. Mvula, whilst he was a beautiful male leopard, and he still is a beautiful male leopard, to me is not all that large. I've only had a couple of sightings with him. He's an exceptionally good-looking leopard, but I would not have said that he was anywhere as close to as large as the Anderson male. And I mean, to be fair, the Anderson male is absolutely the exception to the rule. Now, Mvula, now that he is starting to age, is actually far smaller than both the Anderson male and Tingana. Tingana is all head and shoulders. He's got quite a skinny rear end, but he has very powerful forequarters. So that would be my summation of the lip in order. The Anderson male, in order of the ones that we are most likely to see of a mature age, the Anderson male, Tingana, and then Mvula. I'm not sure where Gijima falls in that particular ranking in terms of size. I think, though, it is very telling that Mvula decided to cross into Simbabili. The reason I say that is that is so far beyond his usual territorial movements, and it suggests to me that he is running a bit scared of Gijima. That he's moved that far west. Look how empty Boyatela Dam is looking already. Just to give you a rough idea. Oh, Donna, apparently I referred recently to a female running fast in terms of looking at the tracks, and you were wondering how on earth I know that. Donna, when it gets a little bit lighter, I'll be able to explain to you with diagrams, but essentially for any of the cat species, when their feet register, so when the back foot falls on top of the front foot, that's a relatively slow speed. The further in front of the front track, the back track moves, the faster that animal is walking. And when they start to run, you quite often get the tiniest imprint of the claw. Either way, you can see the stride changing completely. So that is how I know the difference between a slow walking cat and a rapidly moving cat. For other animals, something like an antelope, they tend to dig deeper into the soil as they run. So it very much depends on what it is. Donna, to be completely honest, I can't remember what I was referring to in that particular respect. Somewhere around quarantine, there's also a ground hornbill calling. An oriole, black-headed oriole. It's a bit dark for us to be finding them. And I'm actually quite, to be completely honest, I'm quite blindsided by the presence of the clouds. That is not something I was expecting. I thought we were going to have a crisp and clear autumn morning. Is that Dawn is watching Safari Live in a plane from 35,000 feet above ground level on her way to Chicago. That's amazing, Dawn. Oh, sorry, on her way to Europe. That's incredible. What a way to pass the flight time. Definitely, to me, the best way to approach a long distance flight. Right at that time of the morning where the spotlight is no longer a help but a hindrance. We'll pop that down. So Dawn, watching all the way on the plane at 35,000 feet, that you are roughly the height, almost, you're a little bit higher, but you are almost roughly the height of the highest recorded flying bird, or one of the highest recorded flying birds. The vultures, and in particular the, the Rupel's vulture, or Rupel's griffin, is capable of reaching up to 32,000 feet, or has been recorded to reach 32,000 feet. Something that we might encounter on this reserve, probably a little bit unlikely though. I would be very surprised. Nevertheless, all of our vulture species capable of reaching such enormous heights above the ground. And that's one of the amazing things about birds, because it is, first of all, the oxygen layer is, or the oxygen concentration is particularly thin at that altitude. And obviously, whilst Dawn is flying, her cabin is pressurized rather than the incredibly low pressures at that height. And then you've got the cold, all of which our planes are built to insulate us from, but for birds, they have the feather lining. They also have breathing sacs within their body cavities, so an extension of their lungs, essentially, with oxygen sacs around them, allows them to maintain the incredibly high energy process of flight at those sorts of heights. My guess, I want to just slowly move around here. My guess is that Karula came south from her position. But I don't really know specifically why I say that. It's a guess more than anything else. I almost immediately stopped following her last night. As soon as she disappeared from view, I let her get on with her nightly business of hunting, opportunistically hunting and moving through the area. I haven't picked up on any of her tracks, but driving around in the dark, there's a good chance that she moved through here without me picking up on them. Debbie. Debbie's watching and would like to have an update on the various lion movements from around the area. Oh, it's actually quite chilly. Debbie, most of the Birmingham boys were seen to the east of the Mulwanini yesterday afternoon, to give you a better description of where that is, and I promise you it's somewhere that you're going to get relatively familiar with in a very short space of time once we start traversing Cheetah Plains. It is the drainage line equivalent, so the creek or river system equivalent of the Mulwati drainage line, just that little bit further to the east on Gowrie Main. So it's the drainage line system that flows through Torchwood. And that is where some of them were seen. Brent had one of them on the buffalo kill yesterday. Amazing that they are still, or that at least one of them is still feeding off the buffalo kill.
on Arethusa, or was yesterday afternoon. I'm assuming he's decided to move off by now. And then Nkuma's are a bit of a mystery to me, to be completely honest. They're a bit of a mystery to everyone. Last tracks wandered into Arethusa, but that was days ago. I'm guessing they might have moved west, but that is a guess. I honestly don't know where they were. And last sighting of the Styx females was around Little Gowrie on their way moving to the east. So that's the update on them. All three Styx are still together, so the most pregnant female hasn't gone off to go give birth. The Nkuhumas are cryptic at the moment, if I could describe them like that. And the Birmingham boys are split up in various directions to the south and to the west of us. And that's my lion update for the morning. Let's find out how Brent's morning is going.
So unfortunately, we've had no luck with the tracks just yet. So what Jandre and I are going to do is head towards the western boundary called Triple M North and see. Hopefully she hasn't crossed. Hopefully she still is in that block where we last saw her last night. And hopefully we'll either hear some alarm calls or find some fresh tracks, which will actually give us an idea of where she might be. Seems to be getting colder this morning as we continue on, so I've rolled down my sleeves. I'm trying to button them up, and of course this is taking quite a lot of dexterity while driving. Hello, old men. Oh, not so happy to see us this morning. Some old buffalo bulls. Now we're right on one of the highest points of Juma, and as it starts to get colder, these old buffalo bulls in the evenings will move up to these crests and enjoy the slightly warmer temperature that happens here for a bit after dark due to the fact that warm air rises. So they'll move out of the dry riverbeds and from the pans and come steep up on top of the crests. Well, nice old boys, they don't seem too happy to see us this morning. Moving off into the thicket, so we're going to continue our search for a female leopard. Evie in Long Island is wondering, what is the coldest temperature we get here? Well, and have we ever seen snow? Evie, I think the last time it snowed in the Sabi Sands was probably a millennia ago, even longer. But we don't really get snow in this part of the world. And in the last 10 or so years, I've only ever seen frost once. So not a common place here, but on average during the middle of winter we can probably work on about 4 degrees Celsius in the early morning. Now with the wind chill factor it works out to about 0 Celsius, but 4 degrees Celsius in Fahrenheit is about 39, and that's only really in the very early morning, but it quickly works its way up to during the day about 30 degrees Celsius, and that is, I think if I remember correctly, around 86 Fahrenheit, 86 or 87 Fahrenheit, but we can get down as low as about 0 or -1 Celsius, which is 32, I think 0 is 32 Fahrenheit. But it does get a little bit chilly, but the main factor of why it feels so cold is because we are in open vehicles. So while we're driving, it's the wind chill factor, which makes it feel much colder. Raisa, you and me both, I'd really like to find Shadow to have a look at that wound again. I didn't have a good look at it because she was hunting last night. We didn't keep the light on her for very long. So it would be very interesting to have a look at that wound. It might not even be a wound. I just saw blood on her stomach. So maybe she killed something small. And now we're going to check the western boundary and see if she maybe crossed. Okay, so apparently we've got a bit of a problem with our audio. So while we try and fix that, let's see if we can go back to Jamie. So we're going to jump back on with Jamie while we try and fix this weird in our audio.
Of where Karula decided to move off to last night, I'm trying to work out which particular drainage line she might have moved her cubs to, and just all I want to see is her track. Not necessarily actively seeking her out, but it would be really nice to know. We had a discussion as guides about the possibility of her denning around the tree house. The tree house dam to the river system, if we could call it that, the Mulwati.
So audio fixed, we're back. And we'll be going to be checking very carefully and very slowly along this road. It is one of the main access roads in the Sabi Sand, so it does get a little bit of traffic. But hopefully we're early enough to beat most of the traffic, so we can still see tracks nicely. Jandre is whistling at me, which means he's seen tracks somewhere. He says it's a leopard track, but is it a hyena?
This is a hyena going that way.
Oh, we'll check now, Jandre. We will check now. And Jandre is correct, and it does look like Madame Shadow. There is leopard tracks here. There is leopard tracks. What horrific English there is. So there we go, walking down the edge of the road. So there are hyena tracks, but the one on the right is the leopard. So in this low light, it is quite difficult to see, so well spotted, Jandre. We're going to be turning around because it looks like she gave up on those impala. Oh, that's a big bump. Now, where has she crossed? Or if she has. So I do apologize, my head is going to be hanging over the door quite a bit. I don't want to miss where she crosses. Let me just get onto the Arethusa channel. A nice new set of tracks. She came and scent marked on this tree. But where did she? There she went. Morning, mobile stations. Is anyone copying me?
Bye for your
when he said, I've got tracks of Shadow from where we had her last night, heading south down Triple M North, quite close to the Impala Plains Junction. We're just to the north of that at the moment. But tracks here, sorry, heading south down Triple M North.
Copy, carry on following. I'm on my foot here and coming up to Red Dam. I'll just look here. If I see anything, I'll give you a shout. But yeah, lines are first.
Copy, thanks very much. So here we go. We've still got the trucks. It is, as I said, quite a busy road. So sometimes it is quite difficult to follow her. And I haven't had it. Is that her or is that a hyena? That is a hyena. Let's just check. She maybe did a sneaky puff out of maneuver from those nice last set of nice tracks that we saw. Yeah. Shadow, shadow, where art thou? We did see some nice tracks around. Yeah, there we go. There's a nice clear track. There's the last clear track. Just jump out of the vehicle quickly, just to make sure I don't miss anything. And doing our little bit as well. We found a bit of stuff that's not supposed to be here. Obviously, looks like this has fallen off a spare wheel with the bolts that holds the spare wheel in back. Always good to have a few spare bolts. I know the wildebeest would like one, or two, or three, or five. So the last very clear track was just over there. Walked onto this very hard patch. So I'm just gonna wander here a little bit and see if I can see either where she's crossed onto this and maybe gone into Arethusa, or whether she's just wandered down this very hard, smooth, graded section. Sometimes it's always good to change the angle, look back if you're a little bit unsure. So it always helps when there's a bit of light, so using the headlights here. Here we go, very faint, but there are tracks there. And here we go, this is the spot. So, so faint, you can barely see them. That's definitely her going this way. Okay, let's carry on. Oh, sneaky, she just went for a set mark and now she's back. Walking on this really hard area. That's why we often get out of the vehicle to see tracks. So even though our heads are hanging off the side, it is very difficult when you're driving to see tracks that are on slightly hard substrate. But here we go, we found where she is now. And she's continuing on. I'm not even going to attempt to show you the tracks. They're almost impossible to see. We can try. So, and can you get where my foot scraped there, John? Oh no, I'm too close. Sorry, that was my fault. Okay, now, let me just wait for Jean-Ré to zoom in, I'll try. So, okay, where's my finger? That is hyena. Now there is the faintest impression of a leopard track. So that's what I'm looking for. It's not even a full track because she's walking on very hard ground. But we are on the right track. Ha 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 ha, I'm so funny this morning. But I am gonna still be going extremely slowly. make sure I don't miss her tracks. It's amazing, just this little bit of extra height we are now, and I find them so much more difficult to see than when I'm walking. And one of the greatest challenges about tracking down this particular area is we've got lots of traffic, like this vehicle coming up towards us now. Okay, there's another track there. So all we need is one person to drive in the slightly wrong spot. And goodbye, track. And she done another runner on me. What happens is quite often when a female leopard is walking or a male leopard is walking down the road like this, and she'll often zig off, scent mark against the bush, and then come back. It always pays sometimes to check a little bit further. Here's an example of her actually almost smell scent mark. So there you can see she's walked dip, 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 up to the bush. She would have turned her tail, sprayed urine, and then carried on.
Slumming draws here. Parallel road, north of Knobforth, plan open.
Okay, so now she's decided not to walk on the very edge of the road. She's walking in the center of the road. Now that, of course, is a problem with the amount of vehicles that traverse up and down. We're just gonna have to go very slowly again. Now, where I'm expecting to find tracks, so if you know leopards and you think like a leopard, I'm guessing she might scent mark that bush. So even if I don't have tracks in this section, I'm gonna go and check right there, because that looks like a good spot for a leopard to scent mark. So quite often with tracking, you've got two very different types of tracking. You've got to either go track to track to track, or you must try and think like a leopard. So I'm going with the faster version of going track to track. We can always come back and do track to track to track if we don't find any tracks up ahead. Let's just keep going for a little bit. Go so slowly while you're tracking. Jandre, anything your side? She might have meandered to the other side. And it is great having cameramen who can differentiate a leopard from a hyena track. And we can thank Jandre, we even have tracks to follow. I think she's walking on this very hard surface that's been graded on the edge of the road again. So let's keep my eyes peeled. Now, there we go. Thank you, Jandre. So she's walking on the other side of the road at the moment. So Bud, he's in North Carolina, says he has trouble picturing these big cats moving great distances while they have cubs. Can't picture Karula moving so far and so quickly with cubs. Is she keeping them in a den? Yes, but she will leave them in a den for quite a while, till they're about a year old. And even then, she still might leave them in an area rather than a den.
Make sure
it's a good area with nice trees or thickets for them to hide in. But that's how she's able to traverse and hunt. Because if you have a cub with you, it can make life quite difficult for hunting. Okay, so I haven't seen the last tracks we had on that side. Maybe she's zagged instead of zigged. She's gone back into Juma. We're gonna keep going. There's a road coming up and a lot of leopards, especially when there's a lot of dew around, like this morning. And she's back. And she's come to scent mark this bush. Did she carry on straight past there? Yeah, she's carrying on. Walking on the hard soils. But they will leave them in the den, and sometimes they'll leave them alone in the den for up to 3 or 4 days, just depending on the age. On average, they never leave them for more than 2 days, but I have seen a female leopard leave cubs for, I think it was about 5 days, 5 nights in total. Keep tracking. Hopefully, there we go. We've still got tracks. She's still walking here. So every now and then, I'm just getting a nice track off and on the hard stuff. Now, this is really exciting. I mean, we're tracking a female leopard live on safari in South Africa. Do forgive me for not looking up too often. I really want to make sure we don't miss where her tracks might cut off the road. So here we're coming up to the next road junction. So this is one of the routes she likes to take, so let's have a careful check here. I'm going to jump out of the vehicle again. See if she's headed into Arethusa or she's kept on going down Triple M. Good as well to just listen for a bit. While we stop the vehicle and I'm checking for tracks, my ears are working overtime to try and hear anything. So nothing there just yet. Just have a quick look down the road. Maybe she came this side. So we've got no tracks here. That doesn't mean she hasn't walked here. It could mean a vehicle has driven over her tracks. So we're going to check further on. And only if we don't find tracks further on will we go back to the last set of tracks. that tracking has been described by as an art. And I'm concentrating quite heavily at the moment, not only with my eyes, with my ears as well. Anything your side there, Jandre? Okay, we're gonna go as far as that tree there to double check for tracks. If nothing, we'll go back to the last track. Oh. And while you're tracking leopards, there we go. Giant land snail and shadows tracks all in one. So there's the land snail. It's a big one. Slowly mounting the side of the road. But that's not what we're after this morning. We're on hot on the trail of a female leopard, and her tracks are going to come into frame. There they are. So let's keep on them. So she's not walking on the side, she's walking in the almost center of the road. Unfortunately, it is where vehicles drive. But so far, our luck is holding. No one has driven over them too much that I can't see them. Still there. Ooh, and gone. Did she just sneak off the road? Okay, and we've got her again here. Oh dear. This is, as I said, one of the big problems with tracking leopards down main access roads. So I've still got tracks here. Is that there are a lot of vehicles. Oh, and it's Michael, young Michael from Cheetah Plans. Are you going on leave, young Michael?
I'm going on leave.
Oh no, good riddance then.
Yeah.
Bye, I hope we don't see you soon.
Yeah,
no, I'm joking. Enjoy your leave.
Good luck, yeah, no worries.
You see anything on your trip from the lodge?
No, but there's some kind of call out, I think.
Okay. Oh, cool. Well, there we go, guys. Quarantine. One of a lot of your favorite leopards was seen last night on Cheetah Plains. Well, Mike, enjoy
right.
your leave.
No problem.
Don't get into too much trouble with all those young ladies out there now.
Won't do.
Cheers. Okay. Oh, wasn't that nice? Young Michael didn't drive over Shadow's tracks either. All of a sudden, that is why all of a sudden the tracks disappear, because they have been driven over. So when tracks have been driven over, I have to look even more carefully. But so far so good, she's not making it too difficult for us just yet. Now, Deanna was wondering, could she be in a tree? Well, There's a great misconception that leopards spend an inordinate amount of time in trees. They don't. Most of the time they're on the ground. The only time leopards really utilize trees is when they have a kill to hoist, or if it's a particularly hot, they try and get up there where there's a little bit more breeze and to get away not only from the heat but also from the biting flies. And the other third option for using a tree is to get away from a potential threat when they're being chased by something. And Clown Sharon is wondering how long leopard scent marks can last for if it hasn't been raining. Well, Sharon, it depends completely, and Sharon also likes to know, can it be smelt by humans? Yes, it can, and it has the most wonderful smell of buttered popcorn. But when you smell that, it's generally very fresh, so within the last sort of half an hour, 45 minutes. So I can't smell these yet, but if I do start smelling them, then we can start getting excited. It means we're very close on Madam Shadow's tail. Okay, we've still got tracks. She is really marching the Triple M boundary at the moment. Well, thank you, Anna Marie, for your faith in me. Anna Marie says, her gut says, I'm going to find the female leopard this morning. She just knows it. Well, thanks for your vote of confidence, Anna Marie. I will try my best. Your side, John Doe, nothing. Maybe she's gone back onto this hard, graded surface. She has. She might cross across to your side there. Jump, driven over. So let's look a bit beyond. She's on this hard surface again. So let's give you guys a bit of homework while I'm looking for this leopard. While I'm looking for this leopard, let's give you guys some homework. Jean-André, actually you guys decide what type of quiz would you like. Would you like a mammal quiz, a reptile quiz, a tree quiz, a flower quiz? You guys let me know, and let me know what type of quiz you would like to do while my head is peering over the void that is the side of the Land Rover looking for Shadow's tracks. And you can let us know what type of quiz you'd like to do by popping us an email on questions@wildearth.tv or using the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Now, there is a reason why you've been with me so long. Jamie has had another explosion of gremlins. The tech department are with her trying to figure out how to exterminate them. I haven't seen tracks for a while now. I'm going to check up ahead where there's some soft sand there. And there she's... there she is. She's veered back into the center of the road. Tracks have been half driven over. Come, John, just spot her in the red so I can stop staring at the ground. Okay, so her tracks were being driven over, and her tracks have now been definitely driven over. But general direction is still due south almost. your side, Jean-André? And sorry, I missed the name, but someone said they love the fact that our cameraman can track nearly as well as we can. We do too. It is a massive benefit. You're able to have another set of eyes. You can check that side of the vehicle for us. Linda in Virginia. Well, thanks, Linda. I'm sure the cameramen do appreciate a little bit of recognition for their tracking skills. There we go. Yeah, I haven't seen a truck for a while. As I said, since we've been here, we've had two vehicles. So they could have driven over. Unless, there they are. Yep. There they are. We're in the center of the road now. I can't see them again, but there are car tracks there. Now the trick is to make sure we spot them if they cross out when we can't see them there. Continue to track. It seems like Jamie has beaten off some of her gremlins, so let's go see what she's been up to.
Look at this spectacular elephant bull that is moving away from us at the moment. I'm going to try and get you a better view rather than a grey shape disappearing off into the bush. He is a stunningly large male. I'm hoping that we might be able to follow up. Let's go towards the fire break and just see. He's definitely moving fairly quickly. Now, we've spoken a lot about the drought and the fact that it has thrown things into something of a confusion. And that includes the elephants of this area. So some of them have come in from the western side of Kruger, and that's a huge space. I mean, I can't remember the exact statistic, but it's something like 2% of the Kruger National Park is drivable by the average visitor. So somebody coming along the tourist roads. There's a chance that the elephant bulls are coming in from an area where they haven't been all that familiar with vehicles. I think might be the case with this gentleman. Where did he go? I wouldn't think it would be that easy to lose a 4-ton elephant, 5-ton elephant. There's 10,000 odd pounds of animal moving in this area. Here he goes. Oh boy. Don't go that way. Sorry, let me try and find a clearer view. I am on my way to the hyena den. Seems as though we are a bit restricted to good signal areas. Wendy has been attacked by gremlins once again. Go, Kimber. You've been missing November and would love to go to the hyena den. And I know recently I've only gone during the sunset safaris. It'd be nice to go in the morning, and it's nice and cool this morning, so there's a good chance they'll be out and about. He's gonna push over this marula tree. Hello, boy. Jimmy, spectacular. Stop here. He's a bit unsettled. He's just keeping an eye on us out of the corner of his eye. That body language looking back over his shoulder. And this, just gauging by our rear view, the size of his tusks, as well as how prominent his spine is, I would say we're looking at a relatively old elephant.
35 years or older. In fact, I would probably guess 40 plus. And once they get older, their skin starts to lose elasticity. And their skeletal structure becomes more visible. It's most clearly visible in the head, where the skin starts to collapse in around the temporal regions. He's a very large boy. And Aqua, as we try and stay with him as respectfully as possible, you were saying you would love to ride shotgun, but our seats are always occupied by guidebooks and various other things. At the moment, my current shotgun passenger is a book on insects, and my binoculars, and a jacket, an extra jacket, which happens to be Kirsty's, actually. I must really return it to her at some point. And a hat. Now, those are my current shotgun passenger. Yes, driving with reference books is always a very important part of being a guide. There's always something that you will encounter that you don't know the answer to. All right, we're going to get a view of him, and then we're going to leave him, just because he's clearly not comfortable with our vehicle, and it's just going to keep causing him to move further and further away. No, he's on his way. He's unhappy. We'll just move out of the block and away from him. Whilst he's not going to be aggressive in any way, he's just going to keep moving away from us. There's a nice, not such a clear view. All right, boy. This is what I mean. I think he's a Kruger elephant. He's coming from an area where he's not that familiar with vehicles. He might also be very thirsty and on his way for a drink, of course. That's also a possibility. Oh, he's feeding quite comfortably, but he's got a very clear... There's different zones when you approach an animal. There's the comfort zone, and he's got quite a large comfort zone. His comfort zone is probably about 50-odd meters, so about 150 feet. We're just going to let him carry on his morning business, try to ignore the flies that are accompanying him. And Megan, while we leave our elephant, you were wondering about how we learn as much as we do about the bush and the animals, and whether or not we have a university degree in it. And the answer is no. In fact, I don't think any of the current guides have a university degree specifically geared towards what we do. For example, my university degree is, or was, in law. As you can see, my legal career striving ahead. It went very successfully for me. But learning about the world out here and nature out here is very much a matter of time spent and experience. And a burning desire to constantly learn more about what it is we're seeing in our world. And the best guides that I've met in the industry have all been... They've all been a very wide and diverse range of people. And everyone, Brent, myself, James included, and Scott, and Steph, are all united by this common burning desire to learn more about the world in which we live, and in particular the bushveld. So whilst you do have to study, you definitely do, and there are set exams that are geared towards learning to be a guide, there are government qualifications that you have to follow. Most important in my opinion,
making such a noise, Wendy? Let's just try doing that. There we go. Most of it comes in terms of being out and experiencing and just spending as much time as possible in the bush. And bearing in mind, of course, I would love to know how much ground I have covered, how much area I have driven in my time. And I'm sure the same goes for all of the other guides and presenters in this particular company. Hello. Sorry, Megan, distracted by the company of Buffalo Bulls, some Duggar boys. One standing watching us very carefully. And then one lying down at the back. And there you go, Megan. A question that you had about the Buffalo Bulls or buffalo, the way in which buffalo herds work. You said that you always see the males separate from the rest of the breeding herd. Now, that is the two sort of different buffalo social structures that you can encounter. We're looking at the one, which is a group of Duggar boys, we refer to them as, which basically means mud boys. Once they reach a certain age, they become not antisocial, but they do prefer to move away from the company of the herd. You very commonly see them in groups of one or two. I must say, I have seen larger herds of these bachelor males than I have ever seen anywhere else since starting to work on Juma. My record, I think, was somewhere close to 50-odd bachelor males, which is relatively unusual. Usually you see them in sort of twos or threes. I'm not sure what it is. I don't know if it's the dams in this region or if the drought is affecting their behavior in some way. Oh, you see the bachelor groups like this. And then, Megan, you'll also get the breeding herd of close to 500 or more odd animals. The biggest herd I've seen recently was easily close to 1,000, spread out over a kilometer, so over half a mile in distance that this herd was spread. And that's a combination of females and their calves, and then a couple of males spread out throughout the herd of a similar age to the ones that we were looking at there. It's just up to the individual buffalo male where they decide to be. I was just listening to that woodpecker. I was hoping he might decide to come out. One of the many woodpecker species, potentially. Leave my buffalo herd, or my buffalo balls for now. Carry on before it gets too warm towards the hyena den. We'll see if they're active at all. But yes, Megan, there's different combinations of buffalo herd dynamics. A couple of weeks ago, we were seeing relatively small breeding herds. So 100, maybe 200 individuals at a time, which is totally different to the way in which I started at Juma, where we were seeing 500 odd buffalo together in one herd. And I really honestly think that is to do with the drought. Megan, back to your original question about university degrees and how you learn as much as we have about the bush. Sort of trying to figure out why Wendy's making such a peculiar sound. I think it's just dust. What I was actually going to say on that subject is you'd be surprised how much of being a guide revolves around knowledge, not just bush-based, but also to do with, first of all, general knowledge of current events of the world around you, because you cannot host guests, international guests, without knowing something of what is happening in their everyday lives so that you are able to carry on a conversation that doesn't necessarily revolve around the bush. And we do spend an incredible amount of time out here, so that's generally between, you know, in amongst each other at camp, that's generally what our conversation will revolve around. But you cannot be restricted to that with various guests in the that come to visit. And then mechanical knowledge, soil types, management of an area. Occasionally anti-poaching, there are certain jobs where it is required. Megan, it's an absolute pleasure. That is what, I don't think we would have nearly the same live safari experience if we couldn't answer questions. I think it would be a very, very different, I don't want to call it a product, it would just be a very different drive if we didn't have the interaction from the viewers. Megan, I'm going to turn that around and say thank you for sending through your questions and your comments. They make our day, they really do. Because a lot of the time, you look back and you know that the cameraman basically knows what you're saying or can predict exactly what it is you're going to say. But to hear the reaction from the viewers and to know that you're reaching out to people across the globe and that they're thinking about what it is you're saying and that it impacts in some way on people's lives around the world, to me is one of the biggest draw cards of these live safaris. Coming across towards the hyena den, Kimber, and for many others who aren't always able to watch the sunset safari. This den has been exceptionally active. Let's see if we can't find November. I think I see somebody sitting at the entrance to the den. Hopefully the adults are present so that the cubs are out. And how are you? Looks like the December twins. This is my other favorite aspect of these live safaris, is being able to follow an animal's story, as we have with these cubs, from birth. You sent almost from birth up until their adulthood. Just one moment, let's just listen. November's appeared. We've got the December twins and November. Now looking back at one of the best hyena sightings I've had was November when he was still very young, imitating that whooping contact call that we were just listening to. Ooh. And November was still barely without spots. He was still very tiny and trying to imitate the sounds of the adults. And watching that sort of imitation of adult behavior, also one of the incredible aspects of spending time at the hyena den, whether it's the anal pasting that they do, or the whooping contact calls. I was really hoping that these guys might respond to that call. But I think because a female that's just left the den was right here just a few moments ago, I don't think the cubs feel inclined to imitate. You can still see the impact that it has on them, though.
ears up and listening. Michelle, you were wondering, since with all of the moves you've lost track a little bit about where we are or of where we are. Yes, we are still close to the Aubrey's Road Den. It's one of those fascinating aspects of the Aubrey's Road choice of hyenas that they seem to go from termite mound to termite mound. I spoke a lot about this when they moved back here, and the fact that when we first found this den, and it was actually them and myself who found the Aubrey's Road Den initially, purely by chance. We were at an elephant sighting and a hyena cub happened to wander in many months ago. And they did exactly the same thing that they've done this time around, which is move from den site to den site within a very small proximity of each other. Or within a very close proximity, sorry, not a small, very close proximity of each other, very small area. And I have absolutely no idea why that is. Sorry, guys, just listening to the Game Drive channel for a second. Guys just chatting about whether or not they've found any tracks for Karula. None of us have, which is astounding. She does seem to move very cryptically. But yes, we are very close to the Aubrey's Road den site. We're about 100 or so odd meters, probably even less, from their old den. Or are we going to bed? Maybe not. Enjoying a little bit of warmth that's coming through now from the rising sun. And I think we arrived with perfect timing because the cubs are planning their bedtime and time to go back into the den. Have you got an itch there, little one? This cub actually had a grass stem attached to its nose for the longest time. I'm not sure if any of you saw that. Now, Sandra's saying that she loves the cubs, but not too crazy about the adults that give her the chills. Fair enough, Sandra. Everybody has their own perception of the animals out here. Personally, I enjoy all aspects of spotted hyenas, but I can understand what it is about the spotted hyena adults that maybe gives you the chills. There is, I must say, there is a very calculating expression that they can form, thinking about the ways in which they can manipulate us. They have evolved alongside us and particularly evolved living off any of our waste products that we might leave behind. For example, there is a hyena within the camp in which most of our crew live that has learned to come in and attempt to steal the dustbin. Now we've now started putting the dustbin inside at night, but this hyena has learned that even if the gate is closed, there are secret ways in. But instead of tipping over the dustbin and risking alerting everybody to its presence within camp, this particular hyena, whichever one it may be, and I don't know which one it is, I think it's one of the sub-adults, just judging by the tracks that move through or that we see the next morning in camp, has learned, and I mean, I'm talking about a dustbin, this is now something we've changed completely, but I'm talking about a really big sort of black bin, garbage bin, sorry, a trash bin or a garbage bin, that it's learned, instead of tipping it over, to drag outside. So outside of the camp so that it doesn't make too much of a noise when it does decide to tip it over. And it took us a long time to catch on to a way in which to stop this from happening. It's because the hyenas are so clever in the way in which they attempt to scavenge the various leftovers. But this hyena was dragging the entire garbage bin that must have been twice its height, probably more than twice its height, outside before making a noise by tipping it over. And that to me is also a very clear sign of intelligence. So I can understand how one might find hyenas a little bit confusing in the way in which they work. They've all gone to bed now. Siberia Zumi, I think you've got a good plan. Ooh, there's one of them lying off at the back. The sub-adult's getting a little bit too big for the hyena den burrows itself. Siberia Zumi would like the hyena whoop as his ringtone. I like that idea. I feel as though I've missed an opportunity to do that. Perhaps next time we get a hyena whooping very close to the car, you'll be able to record it and set it as your ringtone. Although I'm sure there are plenty of examples on the internet that you could probably get hold of. It's my it's one of my favorite sounds of the African bush, is that low contact call. And when you get them calling right next to you or close to you, you really get an impression of the first part of that call, which you don't really hear. As soon as they're a couple of meters away, you don't hear it. But that initial growling stage, it's almost like a lion's roar, that initial it's awesome. It vibrates right through your chest. And I think we're probably going to move out now that the cubs have gone to bed. There's two hyenas lying up. I'm not sure at this distance which ones they are. Fair enough, Sandra, totally fair enough. Sandra said that she's seen so many videos of them ripping animals apart and even killing lions. It's one of those interesting aspects, and I think a lot of our opinions of animals are influenced by popular culture. Generally, hyenas as hunters, rather than as scavengers, actually kill their prey faster than lions do. And I mean, I've seen lions. We had a sighting with James not too long ago, and I've had a sighting very recently with Nikki and Kirsty, where we went out looking for the lions and we found them hunting buffalo, where it's taken them, particularly with small prey that they know can't escape them or can't hurt them, that they basically essentially started eating alive because they don't bother with to suffocate the animal first. And that is incredibly brutal. But animals are not, of course, governed by our moral compass in the same way that we view animals and animal suffering. And it's very difficult for us to watch a sighting like that. So hyenas generally kill, same as wild dogs, although it's something that people perceive as very brutal. It's quite often faster than the way in which lions and leopards kill. Karula, for example, had that baby Dacre that she kept alive and in shock for a very long time. I don't know why she did it. It's something that cats do in the same way it's something that all predators do. Many of you will have domestic cats at home that will very often bring you half-dead animals back, whether they be rodents or birds. It is one of those brutal aspects that we don't necessarily understand, but there's a reason for the way in which animals do that. And hyenas, yes, they'll kill lions. And I actually saw a male lion kill 7 or 8 hyena in one go. It was one of the most brutal things I've ever witnessed. But I completely understand where you're coming from. It's just a perception of the way in which the animals behave. And I honestly think that the popular representation has played a huge role. Here we go. Aqua's just saying, as we get to the point where we're going to leave the hyena den, Aqua's saying that she has succumbed to the enchantment of the spotted hyena and that Safari Live has given her a different perspective. Because yes, very often documentaries, I think, do fall into that trap of picking a side, whether it be the lions or the spotted hyenas, and representing, whenever you see interactions with the different predators, there's always the main character and then the antagonists. That's the way our brains work. That's the way we relate to stories. And definitely nobody at fault. But the one nice thing about our Safari Live drives is that it is live and it's unscripted. So what's happening is what we show you. And it can be brutal. We've had hyena fights where they have torn into each other and ripped ears and feet, and it's very, very difficult for us to watch. But there's always a reason behind what it is we do, and we don't necessarily understand exactly what that reason might be. Now that it's light and the sun has come up a little bit above the horizon, I'm going to go back to where I had Karula last night. I'm going to see if I can't figure out which direction our sneaky favorite leopard has decided to go in, just to figure out, as I said this morning, where she might be denning. While I do that, let's find out how Brent's search is going.
So, an update on those tracks we're following that was shadow. They're headed into a drainage system, and it looks like a good place for a den. So I stopped tracking her there, moved out, because those cubs will be, if they are cubs, a month old. So I don't want to put any pressure on the on where she's possibly got a den. So we've left the area completely, and we've come to go see if we can find Karula and see if she's caught anything overnight. So both her and Shadow were hunting last night when we found them. Unfortunately, it doesn't look like either of them caught anything. Well, Shadow definitely didn't from where we found her tracks. So let's go see if we can find Karula. So we said, say, heading into the center of Juma. Quarantine's just over there. And so she was seen around there. I'm gonna go check a little bit wider, see if she went down towards the Mowati riverbed. But other than that, it's been really quiet out there, both on the radio and in what we're seeing. Carl and Marianne would like a mammal quiz while we work moving around. And
yeah, that's positive.
Possibly,
and
possibly the easiest while we are driving. There was a request for flower quizzes, but we'll do them a little bit later. So a mammal quiz. What to quiz? So if I remember correctly, let's just say 10. You can give me, or maybe 15 members of the order Carnivora. And the two that you have to include is the smallest and the biggest. But give me 15, there's about 22 possible that would occur in the Greater Kruger National Park. Oh, actually, I think it's 24, but so let's say we definitely have about 15 on Juma, members of the order Carnivora, the ones who eat meat. So can anyone give me 15 of those? But the two you have to include is the largest and the smallest. If you know the answers to that, pop me an email on questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. I just need to listen to this. The tracks of some male lions. Unfortunately, they are outside of our traverse area, so we'll just keep checking around here. Angie in Wisconsin is wondering, those tracks of Shadow that we're following up on, how fresh were they from last night or this morning? I would say they were from either late last night or very early this morning, but not shining fresh tracks as in past in the last hour or so. I would say it was quite a bit earlier than that. But hopefully we're going to find some shining fresh tracks shortly. Now, it looks like the starlings have a nest in that hollow tree there. Just see them popping their heads down. Just wait for. To the left slightly, Jandre. Bottom. No,
bottom. I want the bird.
No, I want the bird that's feeding the babies. That one. There we go. It looks like that's a. Oh, off it goes. See that little hole in the trunk there? It definitely looks like they might have a nest in there, as they were looked to be feeding something in that hole. So now, glossy starlings. Looks like they are feeding, finished feeding. So, well, it's good to know. We'll definitely have to come back and check on this nest. They've flown off now. But maybe they're off to go find some more food for the young ones. The young ones should be getting quite big by now already. Jamie was discussing the camp hyenas that often steal the rubbish bins and things if you leave anything out. And Anna-Marie's asked me to regale you with a story from quite a long time ago, but in the Sabi Sands, about the hyenas that got into the kitchen. So I think there were three of them in total, if I remember correctly, that got into a very big commercial lodge kitchen when the trainee chefs forgot to close the door. And they caused absolute havoc. But hyenas have those claws, so anything that is tiled is not very easy for them to run around on. So while we were chasing, trying to chase the hyenas out the door, they would run and then they would try to take the corner, but obviously with those claws there was no grip and they would and smack into the side of the wall. But it did take us a little while to be able to get them out of the kitchen, and it was quite funny. Hyenas running on any hard, smooth surface is highly amusing, because they just don't get any grip and they slip and fall and make quite a fool out of themselves. We have a male impala eating off. Oh, he was eating a buffalo thorn. But at least it is something with a heartbeat. We haven't seen something for a while. And there he is. Now, all by himself. He looks like a nice big male. There could be some more around. But I'm going to be wondering if he's going to be competing for mating rights as the rut starts. Oh, he's got his ears out. Listening. Very alert animals. Impala's main defense against predators like leopards is how alert they are. You can see how his ears are moving, checking where all potential sounds are coming from. Doesn't look like there's any danger too close to him for now. Hello, mister. See if he sits out in the open for us this time. There you go. No. Off he goes. Pays to be cautious when you get eaten by almost everything out here. Now, impala are actually a fascinating species. They have been around in their current form, so completely unchanged, longer than we have. So modern day humans reached their current form about 200,000 years ago. But the impala has been the exact same for 1.6 million years. Isn't that incredible? It's such a successful design. There's been no need for upgrades or improvements. And it was also the most numerous antelope in Africa. So even though you do have massive migrations of certain species like wildebeest in East Africa, if you go from the Southern Africa all the way through up to North Africa, you're going to find impala in the savannas. And they are so successful. One of the reasons they're so successful is because they are not, they're generalists. But, oh, yes, have a panic, Franklin, have a panic. So, being a generalist is not a bad thing. So they don't specialize in their feeding habits like wildebeest, for example, who are very finicky about what they eat, and they're very specific grazers who only eat certain species of grass at certain lengths. Impala will eat grass, trees, shrubs, flowers, whatever they might come across. And of course, in times of drought, it's very good because they can take advantage of almost all the different food sources available to them. Very fleet of foot, and that is their main way to escape predation. They can jump incredible distances, sort of 5-6 meters in a single bound. And of course that helps them evade things like leopards. But the only evading that's happening at the moment seems like the leopards are evading Jamie and I. We've just left some impala, but Jamie's got some that are probably not being as shy as that boy, so let's go have a look.
I'm trying to pick a good position for you to be able to watch this. The impala this morning have lost their minds and are dashing about the drainage line close to quarantine clearings like absolute maniacs. The rutting time is almost upon us. Oh, no, don't go that way. Okay, go that way. All right. Which way are we gonna go? Oh, there they all run. There they go. Oh, back again. I'm gonna try and do a loop. Just to make Fiam's life easier so that it's not behind the vehicle. Back once again on their obstacle course. Look at that, that's so cool. Stotting, perfect example of impala stotting. Well done, Viam. That sort of loping jump, throwing their legs back, almost like a handstand. Oh, here come the rest. Look at that speed. And that's not them running for their lives or anything like that. It's just sheer exuberance. That combined with harassment from the males, although I haven't even seen a male playing a role in this little show of ours. Now where have they all gone? Now that almost handstand-like jump is known as stotting. And it's basically an antelope showing off. Just demonstrating how fit and strong and healthy it is, throwing its back legs up in the air and over its head. And I've seen impala do it to the extent that they almost look as though they're going to snap in half. Well, they don't, of course. They're much more solid than they look. Right, are you guys done yet? Is it time for resting and relaxing where we can't see you? Or are you going to come galloping back out again? They're still thinking about it. A nice cool morning. It's the perfect time for a little bit of exercise first thing in the morning. The stotting is something that's demonstrated by all antelope in different forms and in different ways. Now, a lot of them do a very high trot, wildebeest, for example. Do a very high trot with their legs right up against their stomachs. That's their way of stotting. Impala, as you've seen, do those handstand-like springs where it's almost a rocking motion backwards and forwards. There's one very unique type of stotting known as pronking.
There's only one antelope species that does it, and that is the springbok, the national animal of South Africa, or the national mammal of South Africa. And it's the most incredible. They arch their backs and they draw all four legs up together. Rather than sort of rocking like the impala does, they actually spring upwards like that. And it's phenomenal to watch in slow motion. And they cover, one spring like that can easily cover about 6 meters, which is, what's that, about 18 feet in length, just in one jump, one effortless flying motion. These are the natural born athletes of the bush. These are the sprinters and the long jumpers. Megan has said that as an avid equestrian, she wishes that her horses or the horses that she rides would jump like these impala jump. Absolutely. I can completely understand what you mean. Their athletic ability is astounding. Antelope to me are the sort of the long distance sprinters and the long jumpers and the hurdlers of the Olympic, the national bush, or the international bush Olympics. Buffalo, of course, being rugby players. And it's up to you where you put the rest of them in terms of the sports teams that they would be on. We're gonna go in, off in search and see if I haven't missed Karula's track somewhere on the line, along the line, because apparently she's flown across the roads. I still haven't found where her tracks have gone. While I do that, let's get an update from Brett.
So we are still checking through the center of Juma at the moment on Central Road. So well done to Elaine, who nearly got 15. Elaine got 14 species of the order Carnivora. Michaela got 15, but unfortunately it drops to 13 because two of them were incorrect. Michaela, your two incorrect ones were the crocodile. Although it is a carnivore, it is not of the order Carnivora. It is of the order Crocodilian. So unfortunately that was incorrect. And the other one you got was a correct member of the order Carnivora, but doesn't occur here. And that's the bat-eared fox. So Elaine was the closest with 14. And we're going to run through those species right now. So the easy, obvious ones, and the biggest and the smallest, were the lion and the dwarf mongoose. So the largest member in Africa of the order Carnivora and the smallest. Now, in between there, obviously the easy ones, cheetah, wild dog, spotted hyena. And we will go through the ones that you guys could have used but didn't. But then we had the white-tailed mongoose is another one. Both black-backed and side-striped jackal, or now I'm using can't lion, dwarf mongoose, cheetah, wild dog, spotted hyena, black-backed jackal, side-striped jackal. Am I missing any that I've said so far, Jandre? Caracal, the serval, African wild cat, brings us up to 10. And now, civet, 11, and then both species of genet. The large spotted and small spotted genet takes us up to 13. So I am missing one. I'm just trying to think about what it was. Did we say leopard? No, I didn't say leopard. 14. There we go. So now there are a possible few others, and a few of you had some of them, but not the full. So of course there's the honey badger. There is of, as well as the banded mongoose, the slender mongoose, and what are we now on, 14, 15, 16, 17, and brown hyena is another possibility that have been seen once on the live drives. That takes us to 18. And let's think of more little nocturnal critters. 18, oof, this is where it gets difficult. That's why I only did 15, I think if I remember correctly in my research, there's 22. A couple of them we're very unlikely to see here, like the caper clawless otter, which takes us to 19, sorry. And so, Andre, can you think of any more?
Connor
is our latest member of the tech team, and he has an appetite bigger than a male lion's. But I don't think he falls under the order carnivorage, Andre. Okay, so let's keep thinking. We're on 19 at the moment. So the other one I do remember now is the Salu mongoose, but I've never heard of them being seen in the Sabi Sands. Don't really count that. And this is going to get me now. I'm trying to think of all the little things we see. Oh, yes, water mongoose, number 20. And I have seen tracks of them here. And I think number 21 is the large gray mongoose, or the small gray mongoose, one of those two. Artwolf, number 22, well done, Jandre. So there we go, although the last artwolf officially seen in the Sabi Sands was in 1970s. So well done to Deborah, the armchair traveler. Actually, before I started listing, an answer came through and she got all 15, including the ones we've just listed. So here we go, 22 possible species in the order Carnivora. And I have a personal challenge that I've set myself to see how many of those we can get live on camera. And of course, we've done the easy ones, the hyena, lion, cheetah, wild dog, civet, white-tailed mongoose, slender mongoose, dwarf mongoose. So we're on 9, which is not bad going. Honey badger, number 10. Serval, number 11. I don't know if we put it. Yes, we have. With Scott, but I'm not counting Scott's sightings. I'm counting my sightings. I think we actually have put a genodon, but I couldn't tell you which species. Therefore, it doesn't count. Just going to check this road junction for some tracks here. Oh, there's a wildebeest having a nice roll in the sand. So we are busy checking, even quite far from where Jamie had Karula last night, in case she went wandering. But while we keep checking for leopard tracks, Jamie's got a feathered friend in a tree.
One of the coolest little bird species out here, the crested barbet, one which is a fairly regular sight on our safaris, but if we're lucky, we might get to see him call in response to another crested barbet that's calling off in the distance. At the moment, a bit more preoccupied with realigning his feathers. There you go. One more time for us, buddy. Now, what I was hoping you would do is that trill-like call almost continuously. Now, although those were short examples, the crested barbet is capable of what's known as a circular breathing. So they actually have two windpipes as opposed to the one that we have. And they are capable of breathing out through one, the one obviously that passes through the larynx, and then breathing in through the other. So they can trill for a continuous period of time, far longer than they would normally on just one lung full of air. One of those amazing little facts about this bird. Also a monogamous bird species. And very often when you hear them trill like that, there is a mate somewhere in the vicinity.
is a relative of this bird known as the black-collared barbet, one that we hear regularly but hardly ever see. And that bird call is a duet of even more epic proportions than the crested barbets usually perform, with timing so impeccable that if you were to if you were to hear the call without knowing any better, you would probably think that it was one bird. They sort of sing ornithologists describe it as doopadly, 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 because as people we automatically need to put words to the bird calls that we hear. But the one, the sort of the do part of the do pudley call is the male, and the female follows with pudley. Something that we hear, but we hardly ever see. I haven't seen that many black-collared barbets in this vicinity. Well, for those of you planning visits to Kruger, this is a little bird that you will see very regularly at rest stops. They learn quickly that the various campsites and habitations mean food for them to come and scrounge, crumbs and so on. That will definitely be a bird that you will see many times on journeys into Kruger. Small and brightly coloured. Only in terms of scale, I'm trying to give scale for most things that I see at the moment. Probably about that high. Roughly, a tiny little bird with very robust bill. Isn't it cool? Come on, buddy, call properly. There's so many other crested barbets trilling away. Beautiful. Okay, and my plan is to head back towards Gallagher Pan. As I said, now that it's light, we can potentially see tracks a little bit better. Although I'm surprised by the cloudiness of the morning, but the light is up and we should be able to see them clearly this time around. There's no tracks coming south along Twin Dams, which is where I thought she would go. We were discussing about the Rupel's griffin, or the Rupel's vulture. And Alice was wondering, why would a vulture need to fly to 32,000 feet in the sky? And Alice, generally that's an aberration. They're following thermals right up, and they sit in the hot, rising hot air currents that carry them upwards, and they just get to the point where they are that high and are capable of being that high. But vultures in general are, especially the vultures that locate their food, that applies to all of our species in this area, vultures that locate their potential food through their sight rather than their sense of smell. So the higher they go, and with their binocular vision that is 10 times better than ours, they are able to spot, first of all, potential carcasses on which to scavenge, but also at the same time, they are capable of spotting other vultures on their way down. I was going to stop for these Nyala, but they're also having a game. Here comes number two. Oh, I'm trying to look big and scary, but I'm not really. The animals, the antelope species, are having a ball this morning. This male, much larger than the first one that was running, also mud-tipped horns, or mud-covered horns. I must say, I don't think that there is an antelope that is more attractive than an Inyala male. They really are such pretty antelope. Oh, off again. And the antelope in general really are just having a wonderful time. I want to see where the third one went. Our Nyala disappear into the drainage line of the Mawati. We were speaking about the impala stotting and now the Nyala having a wonderful game as well. Gameback was wondering, would an animal, or would an antelope, display the stotting behavior whilst being chased or hunted by a predator? Because it would seem as though if a leopard tried to jump onto an impala's back whilst it was stotting, they would probably end up with a face full of hooves. That's a really interesting one. Yes, they can display that stotting behavior, but it is usually when the predator has been spotted beforehand, and that applies to all of the antelope species, including these Nyala. So alongside the alarm calls, you will relatively often see that stotting. It's more for the benefit of the other antelope than it is for the predators, but they do display it. So they can, and I've seen impala do it in front of lions, sort of do that bouncing, bounding stride that they do in order to, as if to say, look how healthy I am, don't even bother to try and pick on me. But if the lion is actively hunting and is very close to the antelope, then no, they won't start, they will run. And the same goes for the sudden appearance of wild dogs. As soon as an antelope spots a wild dog, they are gone, not wasting any time or energy with stotting. Bearing in mind, of course, that while stotting is incredible to look at and a serious feat of athleticism, it's slower than genuine running away. I mean, those impala were moving incredibly rapidly, but that was probably about half their full tilt running speed. And Anna Marie is absolutely right. It's going to be incredible to watch when the impala start their rut. For those of you who have only joined Safari Live less than a year ago, oh, sorry, Wendy, forgetting that second gear is not a gear you enjoy. For those of you who've only joined Safari Live recently, you're in for a treat over the next few months. The impala are going to provide endless entertainment. The hormones levels are flying. There we go. More antics from our impala herds. Males are going to be sparring with each other and then genuinely fighting with each other. But the most entertaining to me is watching a male pursue a female that isn't all that interested in his intentions. And he will spend hours upon hours pursuing one female, and she just keeps ducking and diving him. It can be hugely entertaining. And already we're starting to see the split. Oh, Nyala acting up as well. Young male's having a bit of a game. There's a Nyala at the back there by the fence that is dancing with somebody, by the looks of things, right at the back there. All puffed up and enlarged. I don't know who he's dancing with, though. I can't see another Nyala.
There's another one by the tree.
There we go. I can see his tail swishing. I thought perhaps he'd seen a reflection and decided to dance with that, which, by the way, I have seen an Nyala do. I've seen a Nyala do that display slow dance to his reflection in a window. Was one of the funniest things I've ever seen an antelope do, ever. I watched him for ages. Oh, impala fighting or sparring at the back. Now watching the various antics of our different antelope species. Lance has said, in response to my comment, that there's not much more beautiful than an Nyala bull.
Lancer said only the kudu, or the male kudu, beats Inyala in terms of looks. Fair enough point. They are definitely very attractive animals. All of the spiral-horned antelope family are attractive-looking antelope. Bushbuck as well. Bushbuck being my favorite out of that family. About half the size, or more than half the size, of an Inyala. And just look at these antelope. There's at least three sets of sparring males within the Impala. One, two, three. The bachelor groups building up. It's almost like training before a big sporting event. The Inyalas are the dancers of the antelope world. Now, speaking about the different antelope species, Bertie would like to know, or Boti, I'm not actually entirely sure how your name is pronounced. Please let me know. I think it's... apparently it is Bertie. It is definitely Bertie. Bertie would like to know if we have oryx in this particular area. We don't. It is one of my favorite antelope species. An oryx, or a gemsbok, has got long, almost meter in length, so 3 foot long horns that they use to spear either threats or each other. They are more a desert-dwelling species, so more to the western side and the northwestern corners of South Africa. I used to work in a reserve that had many, many oryx moving through, and they definitely are incredible animals. Those spear-like, I've seen them hunted before, hunted by lions or wild dog in particular, and they kneel down on their sort of on their ankles or on their knees, and they fend off predators by just presenting them with essentially a barrier of spears. I'm going to show you exactly what it looks like for those of you who are wondering. It falls under the family of horse antelope. What you up to, Inyala? The antelope also reveling in the wide open space of the dam. Gives them plenty of leeway to spot predators. Here we go, this is what a gemsbok looks like. Unfortunately, not one that we would see here. And I'll show you in a moment a map of their home range. You see what I mean about those incredibly long horns? And they are roughly the size of a medium-sized horse, a little bit larger than a pony, to give you a bit of a sense of scale. Enormous antelope. And there, if we have a look at the map, and we have a look at the range of their territory, you can see how, I mean, this is where the Kalahari Desert falls, and the desert that runs into Namibia, so a much more arid area species. And we sit, in terms of where we are, we sit sort of in this corner here, where my thumbnail falls. So right up in the northeastern corner. But that just gives you a bit of an idea about where the oryx wanders about. They are extraordinary animals, they really are. Fascinating to watch. Sort of grouped together in the same family as sable and roan antelope, which you could see here. Just in terms of size and in terms of body structure. I had a chuckle from the back there. There's obviously a joke that I'm missing out on that's coming across from Rusty. Can we just stop for a moment to look at the Egyptian geese, just because they're always here? Shall we think about putting Eugene on camera? He can wave hello. No, he's distracted. Oh, it's not Eugene. It's Connor. Connor hasn't been on camera yet. Come on, Connor, give us a wave. Not so much. Don't take it personally, though. I don't think he's realized that we're looking at him. Oh, he gave the camera a wave.
a rare, exceptional Connor sighting. Ladies and gentlemen, Connor's just joined our tech team over the last few weeks, so he's still very much getting to know. Now, Connor, I think, is the first person in camp that eats as much as I do. I've been known for my ravenous and almost constant appetite. Connor, I think, actually tops me, and he's sort of roughly just a little bit larger than I am, so he's got one of those metabolisms that just burns through food. Apparently, Gendre nominated him to be part of the Carnivora. Now, last time Connor went to go and sort out the area underneath the camera, Alex and Connor encountered a snake, which they sent through a picture to all of us, but they asked us for an identity on the snake, and can I actually just show you this picture because it's hilarious? It depends on where I put my phone, though. There we go. Apparently that snake is still there, interestingly enough. So this was the picture that they sent us and asked us to identify the snake. I'm not even sure if you can see it. There we go. That was the picture we got. And then a question saying, what is this? I mean, you'd have to be a serious snake expert in order to identify which particular individual snake they were looking at. Apparently it's still there. Not going to go and interrupt Connor, though. He looks quite serious and contemplative, as Connor does. Looks as though he's investigating very carefully. I'm not going to go and interrupt him. All right, shall we move on from Vuyatela Dam? And see if there's no sign of Karula moving about in this area. I think she's given us the slip once again. Potentially, depending on what work Connor has to do, we will potentially go and have a look at that snake, see if we can't figure out what species it is. I'm just going to give Connor a chance to... The tech team have been furiously at work when it comes to the Juma Dam camera, trying to sort it out and get it back under control. And that's what they're currently busy with. Good luck, Connor. Let's have a look and see what bird Brent has got.
So, guys, another great bird for the bird list. It is a cuckoo, and it is very difficult to tell the difference between the African cuckoo and the European cuckoo. So I'm just actually double-checking myself. So the European cuckoo is silent in Africa, and the African cuckoo says, cuckoo, cuckoo, believe it or not. The European cuckoo has a very similar call, but it only calls generally when in Europe. Okay, so it's called a common cuckoo. So we need to look at the bill. So I'm going to try to zoom in with my camera and get a shot. So it's very, 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 very finicky to tell the difference. You actually need to see the bill. I'm just making the settings light, so it's not the best picture, but we'll be able to... Oh, no, I need to make it lighter. Please don't fly, cuckoo. So we need to get the settings, there we go, light like that, so we can look at the bill. So actually, it is not an African cuckoo. I'll pop it on the dash for you, Gendre. So what we're looking at is the coloration of the bill, whether it's more yellow or more dark. So from what I'm seeing here, it's darker extending further down the bill. So if we look here, I mean, the markings are almost identical. So this is a common cuckoo or a European cuckoo. No, sorry, down at the bottom here, Gendre. Here we go. So you can see they look almost identical. Oopsie. Oh no, that's the African cuckoo. So, sorry, I didn't mean to do that. My finger went the wrong place. So you can see how the bottom part of the bill is still very yellow, and it's got a slight reddish in the mouth. And if, I think if we go that way, there we go, there's the common cuckoo. So almost identical, apart from the fact that the black extends further down the mouth part, or the, up down the beak, and it doesn't have that real reddish glow. I just want to check one more thing with the African. And also, when we look whether the yellow around the eye is connected, see, some of that bare skin joins the eye in the common cuckoo, and in the African cuckoo, there's a gap. So now we're going to go back to the photograph and have another look. Now, it just is joining, but it's not that easy to see. And of course, it's not the same in every bird, but just how dark the bill is leading me towards a common cuckoo. So that could be a nice new bird species for those keeping lists, and not one we see too often on camera. We get them flying across, and while we're driving around, we see them quite often, but to have one, I can't believe he's still sitting there. And to sit for that long, oh, as I say that, of course, it takes off. But it did give us a great opportunity to actually take some time and identify it as a common cuckoo. So yay, hopefully that's a new tick to a lot of your bird lists. The nice thing with the way technology is going, we've got all these incredible gadgets that I'm still getting to grasp with, that is going to make it so much easier. Can you believe that I have 1, 2, 3, 4 books on this little thing that normally would be this big, and weigh a lot to carry around? So Deanna's talking about murmurations, and murmurations are those incredible, incredible flocks of starlings that sort of move as one, and she's wondering whether our starlings do that. Not really. We don't get those massive flocks of starlings down in the Lowveld, so we don't get murmurations of starlings. But I think, I'm not sure where that happens. It could be in the US or Europe, where they get those large murmurations that are incredibly beautiful to watch. Probably the bird that comes closest to that for us, but not really in our area, we do see them, they pass through, is the red-billed quelea. Now, I have seen flocks of red-billed quelea in Botswana that literally black out the sky. When I say sometimes those flocks have over 1 million individual birds in them, and they are incredible. They actually can be quite a problem for farmers, because can you imagine 1 million little seed eaters descending on your plantation? Oh, I think they're going to roll. We've got rollers, lilac-breasted rollers, but when they call like that and they fly, sometimes they do the display that earned them their names. Come on, guys.
Looks like a kill.
No, they're not going to roll, unfortunately. So what they normally do is, while they're flying like that, all of a sudden they will plummet towards the ground in this rolling sort of movement. So unfortunately those two weren't doing it, and also Jandre said it looked like one had something, it killed something in its mouth, so maybe the other was chasing it. And we have a not a track this time, but a large millipede. Look at him go. So, a question for you guys. So, apart from millipedes being detritus eaters and fungus eaters, and centipedes being carnivores with large biting mouthparts, if we refer to their legs, what is the difference? So how do you tell the difference between a centipede and a millipede? Now, let me actually go show you the bottom of him. And I think it's probably going to be nicer if I explain it rather than leave it for you guys. Hello, big guy. So So let me just pop him on the dashboard.
He's behind the wheel.
I think he's gonna move forward, so. There we go. No, don't curl up. Oh, he curled up. So that's his defensive posture to make sure nothing can eat him. Let's just have a look a little bit more carefully at him. So now that he's curled up, we can still see, almost see, you see those masses of little legs inside there. So a centipede only has one set of legs per segment, whereas a millipede has multiple, sometimes three pairs of legs per segment. And here we go, another one of his defensive mechanisms there. Now he has defecated. Now, these guys are very nasty to eat for most animals out here. They have a hydrogen cyanide in their system from different things they eat. They can get those poisons from mushrooms, from different flowers. So we're just gonna let him go and continue on his way. So the one thing, and mammal that eats them is the African civet we've been talking about a little bit today. Now, the African civet's pancreas creates a very special amylase that breaks down that poison into non-harmful components so the civet can eat them. Now, that's in this area. Now, strangely enough, we've got a lot of millipedes in the rainforests, and certain dica species will also eat millipedes. So quite a few of the forest dicas will actually even hunt birds, and it is incredible because everyone assumes a forest is this mass of food and stuff like that, but it isn't actually. A lot of the food is very high in the sky. It's great if you're an insect, but even the birds and mammals that live in rainforests actually do struggle to find enough food. So quite often they move big distances and have special adaptations. So like the fact that quite a few of the different dica species, yellowback dica, nigrophons, what's the common name? Oh, I can't remember the common name, I can only remember the scientific name. Black-fronted dica. They all will actually hunt birds and also eat millipedes. So they also have that special amylase that is developed by their pancreas that breaks down those poisons into non-harmful components. Connor the Carnival is back in final control, and he is now very embarrassed that he was waving at the dam camera instead of to Jamie's camera. I'm sure there will be some gentle teasing around the breakfast table. So, Connor, I hope you're ready for that. Monkey on YouTube would like to know, do we have porcupines here? We most certainly do. We have the southern porcupine, which is one of the biggest porcupine species in Africa. We have two porcupine species in Africa. We only have the one down here. The brush-tailed porcupine is a rainforest species, so doesn't live in these parts. And porcupines are nocturnal, so we don't see them too often. I'm not even sure if we've ever put one on the live safaris. I don't think since I've been here, maybe before my time. We definitely will be trying to do that always, especially in this lovely little bit of dark we get at the end of the sunset safaris. They are the largest rodent in Africa. Now, often there's lots of things that a porcupine can shoot its quills. It can't. So it will back itself into a predator with that very, very sharp quills. And porcupines, strange enough, you can often find where they've been feeding off bones, specifically from big old kills like buffalo kills that lions have killed. The porcupine will come feed off the ribs and skull and hip bones and any large bone that's left behind. So The reason they do this is that they, of course, need quite a lot of calcium to keep producing that amount of quills. So they're constantly producing them. And porcupine, strange enough, in a lot of parts of Africa is a delicacy, said to be very, very good to eat. And for example, the sand people or the bushmen from the Kalahari will actively track porcupines back to their dens. Now they live like warthogs and hyenas in disused aardvark burrows, and they will dig them out in the soft sand of the Kalahari. Now, I do have a photo, I should post it one of these days, from a long time ago. It is not uncommon for porcupine and hyena to share a den. So they have a sort of mutual understanding and they'll use different caverns in the den. But not uncommon at all for those two species, very unlikely den mates, but for them to share a den. John, did you get where you stopped? Okay. Let me try to show you with my finger. Oh, I've lost sight of him for a second now. Okay. To the right. Okay. Where are you at? Come foreground a bit closer. Okay, a little bit to the left. Center screen. Oh, zoom. A little bit to the right. Up a little bit, that white dot. Here we go, a brown-veined white, the most common butterfly species we get here. And they are active throughout the year. I think Jandre wants to kill me now for making him film butterflies. I think I'm one of the only ones who gets really excited by the butterflies. I watch cameramen's facial expressions change. Jandre is sitting something like this at the moment. But because he made that face, let us go in search of every butterfly in Juma. Well, I used to like to know, do skinks eat millipedes? I've never seen them. I think a lot of these millipedes are a bit big for our skink species. The animals that I've seen eat the most millipedes here are the red and yellow-billed hornbills. So the birds seem to be far less affected by those poisons than the mammals. But I have seen the hornbills really do eat quite a few millipedes. Now, of course, if we were to eat a millipede, we'd probably be just fine because we're quite big and our body would be able to deal with that small amount of toxins. But I wouldn't recommend it. I'm pretty sure they taste absolutely horrific. And if we're going to get anyone to eat a millipede, I think it should be Jandre. He likes to eat strange things. Well, myself, I've grown out of eating strange things. I've eaten lots of strange things in my travels through Africa. Some of the stuff that I've eaten, you guys would definitely turn your nose up at. But sometimes it is impolite not to eat what you were given in certain circumstances, so you just have to suck it up. I try chew as little as possible and swallow as fast as possible. And sometimes you are pleasantly surprised by certain things that look absolutely disgusting but turn out to be incredibly tasty. Now, I've asked some of the Juma ladies if they can find me some. Apparently, with the drought this year, it is quite rare, but hopefully before the greenery disappears, we'll be able to show you a Shangaan cabbage or gusha. Now, it is a spinach, but it is eaten, I'm not exactly sure how it's prepared, but when you see it, it's basically this green goo. You can see the leaves, but if you have to take it, it's like snot. So it's really slimy, and it looks really disgusting, but it is incredibly tasty. So we will try see if we can get some while it is still green, but the problem is getting some. It's such a delicacy, and it's difficult to get anyone to part with any. Forgot my butterfly book today, but Luke's wondering what is the biggest butterfly species we get here. We managed to actually get it on camera, or its cousin on camera, a few days ago. But it is the emperor swallow-tailed butterfly, which is just a little bit bigger than the citrus swallow-tailed butterfly that we showed on camera. And I will see if we can find one of those. And it is, as the sun comes out and the dew gets a little bit less, the butterflies are going to start getting moving. Now, this is a really good time to look for butterflies because there is still a bit of dew around, but they are moving. So they're not quite as quick as they normally are. But, well, let's go look for some butterflies. And while we do that, Jamie has definitely got something that is on the complete other end of the spectrum to show you.
Definitely the opposite end of the spectrum. Not quite the size of a butterfly, and certainly not quite as delicate or as light-footed. We have a male elephant that I was on my way to Galago Pan, and he decided that he was going to act as a roadblock and really didn't want us anywhere coming along that road. And so, as is the way of things, I decided to concede that he was allowed to use the road first and that we would go back and away from him. He does seem perfectly relaxed now out in the open. I was just giving him a bit of personal space so that I can read his body language. I do think we'll be able to reposition now. He's not a must. He was a little bit grumpy when we saw him earlier, and already I'm seeing him turn his head to look back at us, so we're not going to go very much closer. We're just going to go park on the road and have a nice clearer view of him from behind the tree. I don't particularly feel like being chased by an elephant. He's not all that old either. It's interesting that he's got such attitude. Just looking at his tusk size and his body size, I think he's probably somewhere in his 20s. He's off on his own, which is the standard life for a male elephant that has reached sexual maturity. Matt, you were wondering, do the older elephants within a herd get pushed out, the males? And the answer is yes. Once they reach sort of roughly about 15 years old, and it depends, it differs from elephant to elephant, just like human beings go through puberty at different ages. But once they reach sexual maturity, they will get pushed further and further to the fringes of the herd until they leave of their own accord and are pushed out and wander off on their own. And they usually form, or they quite often form, bachelor herds, so they'll go and find other young males of a similar age. Since being out on your own when you've grown up with the protection of the herd is a pretty scary thing for an elephant, they will often join up with other young males, and sometimes those young males will in turn join up with an older elephant that will essentially teach them all they need to know about being a big, mature bull. He's got some interesting habits, though. The fact that there's a person. Imagine how wonderful it must be to be a guest, staying in the lodge and having this vast array of animal life outside your front door. These two ladies really enjoying the sighting of the elephant. See how relaxed he is with the presence of people walking so close? That would not be the case if he were encountered in the middle of the bush. At the moment, it is so gratifying to see... Oh, let me actually finish off with my thought, sorry. The fact that he is so comfortable with people on foot, as close as those two ladies were, just goes to show how intelligent most animals are in terms of knowing where people live and where to expect people, as opposed to encountering people away from lodges on foot. That's why he was so comfortable with the presence of those two ladies watching him from across the other side of the fence. It's got nothing to do with the fence. As we well know, a fence is nothing to an elephant. Even if it is electrified, it's not a concern to them. You can see that tail swinging like a pendulum from side to side. That's a very relaxed elephant, quite happy. And it's nice to see the elephants once again feeding on grass. We've seen them be... Oh, this is the first time I've seen them concentrate as much as they have on the new growth that has come from the rains. Cheryl, you were wondering, do elephants push down trees to feed, or do they do it to be destructive? That's an interesting one. Most of the time, yes, they push down trees in order to feed. Gets them the nice green leaves at the top. And quite often they push them down into roads because the roads are clearer, so it's easier to gather around the tree and to feed on it without having to be bothered by trees around it. That being said, elephants have temper tantrums, like people have temper tantrums, and occasionally they do just go and push down trees and break down trees. After a discussion with an elephant, he tried to push a tree down on us. I'll finish off that story, but Brent has found a tiny little tortoise for you.
So, Jean-André and I are focusing on the little things out here today, and that is a minute leopard tortoise. Now, how minute, I'm going to show you right now. So, look at this guy, he's so small! Hello, little man, or little girl. Look at that. I mean, not even... It'd fit with space to spare in the palm of my hand. So probably a couple of days old at the most. Look at him go. Even a little bit of grass poses a challenge for him to climb over. So as it gets warmer now, he's probably going to try head into a thicket like this where he's going to hide up for the rest of the day. So at that size, they're very vulnerable to birds and other predators. So he's going to go find a nice shady spot to spend the day. There we go, that looks like a good hidey hole for that tiny little baby leopard tortoise. Isn't that awesome? So I thought we might be finished with that tortoise birth so far, but it looks like not. There's been a hatching, sorry, not a birth. And of course, tortoise don't give birth, they lay eggs. But nice little guy. So let's go back to the big guy with Jamie.
Once again, moving back across the dam wall, I've left our Ellie Bull for now. He's fairly relaxed, but I'm going to just leave him to go about his day-to-day business. I was chatting a bit about elephants pushing over trees and the way in which they can be destructive versus feeding. Most of the time, as I said, it is for feeding purposes, to get to the nice green leaves at the top. And then, as I said, sometimes they do it, first of all, to show off how big and strong they are, and occasionally with a communication purpose. It's like us shouting, essentially. So as I was discussing that incident where a bull elephant came out of nowhere, when him and myself were off air, we'd stopped to look at him. He was about 50 meters away, and he decided, actually, he really didn't like us. And he did the same thing to a couple of vehicles. So that's why it's always important to remember that the animals are wild, and that no matter how well you think you know them, it's important to bear that in mind. And he came and had a brief moment standing right next to the vehicle trying to intimidate us. And when that didn't work, and I'd raised my tone a little bit, tapped the side of the car slightly a couple of times, he then decided what he really wanted to do was push the buffalo thorn down onto Liam. It was at that point that we decided we were going to leave.
overstayed our welcome.
We did, yes. he was very clearly giving us the message that we had overstayed our welcome. Hello, gorgeous. Where did you come from?
We had heard this.
That's an interesting pair. Zebra and a giraffe. Perfect. How lovely. And it's a beautifully relaxed female giraffe as well. What have we got sleeping here? Kingfishers, but which one? It's right close to us. I just wanted to turn his head. It doesn't look like a woodland. Maybe it is a young woodland. It is a young woodland. It just looks a bit scruffy. Young woodland kingfisher. There you go, Sandy. You were asking about giraffe and zebra. She's having a good scratch there. Using the tree to get to those hard-to-reach places. Zebra, I think you're a little bit confused. It's a young male zebra that's following with this giraffe. Now, it is fairly common to see animals together like this of different species, particularly for the general game animals that rely on each other for an extra set of eyes and an extra set of ears, particularly for a lone zebra like this one. It is a young male, so he's just accepted the company of the giraffe in lieu of having a herd to keep him company and to keep him safe. Let's just reposition, because this is a lovely sighting. There's actually two giraffes here. I'm not sure where the second one just disappeared off to. So Megan, you were wondering, what is the most unlikely pairing of species together that I've ever seen? That requires a bit of thought. This is a fairly common sight to see zebra and giraffe together. And by the way, zebra and giraffe is the name of a South African band. Just in case anybody's interested in a little bit more of the local culture. Megan, I'm just thinking, what is the most unusual pairing? Obviously, we've all seen those videos of the lions or the leopards that have either killed a mother or a female antelope or baboon and then adopted their little ones. So, for example, there was the case of the leopard and the baby baboon. There was also the very famous story of the lioness and the baby wildebeest that she was mothering. And sometimes I think that their instincts get a little bit confused. And they're not entirely sure if they are meant to be feeding on a baby or caring for it. Particularly, I think, when pregnancy hormones are involved. There you go, there's the second female giraffe. I'm trying to think, Megan, what the weirdest pairing I've ever seen is. It was the very brief sighting that we had of the Speke's hinge tortoise that was cuddling up to the Styx lioness. Not really a deliberate pairing, but definitely something that occurred that I think has been my strangest pairing this year to date. I'm trying to think, Megan. I think the lions and the tortoise were probably one of my strangest sightings. Sorry, I'm just listening to the Game Drive channel at the same time. Interesting chat that's just happening. Sorry, just got distracted by the chatter on the Game Drive channel. By the way, I'm not sure if Brent has updated you, but that sighting with Tundi on Torchwood includes another leopard, and that is Tingana. It seems as though Tundi and Tingana are mating once again around Torchwood, so hopefully Tingana will persuade Tundi to come and join us on Juma this afternoon or tomorrow. Oh, we've got two female giraffe here. You can tell that by, first of all, their general body shape, and then very much in the obvious way of telling the difference between male and female mammals. It's a very clear distinction in giraffe. One of the other ways that you can have a look, just by judging or having a look at the ossicones, or the horns, on the top of the giraffe's head. See how tufted and black the tops of their horns are, and how thin they are. They're not true horns, as I said. They're known as ossicones, because they are not bones covered in keratin. They are bone covered in skin, unlike most of the antelope species. The males are much, or the ossicones of the males are much thinner, and are rubbed smooth from, or sorry, much thicker, and are rubbed smooth by a process of fighting known as necking, where they swing their heads round and they hit each other on the sides. And since we're talking about telling the difference between species, the obvious way is not so obvious in a zebra. The best way to judge whether or not it's a male or a female is to have a look at the stripes underneath, or the stripe underneath the tail, between the cheeks of his bottom. Now, this is a very thin strip that we can see, and that tells us that it is a male. In females, that black stripe is much thicker and extends further on either side. And that's immediately how I judged that it was a stallion and a young stallion. Look, he's going to follow, I'm sure he's going to follow that giraffe. He is too. He's very deliberately sticking with them. Zebra are naturally herd animals. So without the rest of his bachelor herd, without any other zebra to join, he's decided that the company of giraffe will do. Very liberal-minded individual. I completely agree with James Richards. He says he loves giraffe because they've got such an awkward design, and yet at the same time are such graceful animals. James? Oh, awesome. Well spotted, Viam. Viam multitasking as our cameraman and managing to get a little blue wax ball on your screen at the same time as filming the giraffe and the zebra. Is he gone? Is he come back? Oh, there he is, fluttering about at the back. I feel as though I'm seeing more blue wax balls since the rain. I know Brent had an extraordinary sighting with one. Can you go for one last view of our giraffe? I think they are slowly moving off.
That nesting material.
Pardon?
That other blue wax was doing their nesting material.
Oh, that's interesting. That is really interesting. So Viam says that another blue wax ball flew into this tree with nesting material. Let's see if we can't see. Such a pity it's right into the light. Let me just turn around here. See if we can't see the beginnings of a blue waxbill nest. It would be awesome, and they do like to nest in these thorn trees, like this buffalo thorn. I think that they are nesting on the other side, or starting to build their nest on the other side. Blue waxbills build the most extraordinary little cup-shaped nests, very much looking in very much in similar shape to a teacup. And it is very delicately weaved. Let's try and check the other side of that tree. See if we can't. Oh, I can see exactly where they're going in now. That'll be wonderful if they're building a nest. We can watch their progress. Binoculars flying. If they do choose to nest in here, they're going to pick the densest part of the tree in which to do so. just sit and wait patiently for a moment. See if we can't figure out. The one's just flown in. The nest is right in the thickest part over there. You can see every now and again that little head bobbing movement. That's the blue waxbill in the buffalo thorn. It is currently occupied nest building. Well spotted, VM, that is awesome. Very often the waxbills and the flycatchers of the world will camouflage their nests. As I said, they build these perfect miniature little cup-shaped nests, and what they'll very often do is they'll collect spider webs and wrap them around the edge of their nests to sort of hold the shape together, but also to act as a camouflage. But we'll keep monitoring this nest site, and we'll see if maybe when we can do bushwalks again. We haven't been able to for a little while just because the camera's being sorted out, but when we're back up on foot again, we could actually come and get right up close and have a look at this waxbill nest without disturbing them. I don't want to drive too much closer, but they're definitely building right in that thickest part of the buffalo thorn. Very cool. Amazing how the birds are, even though we're coming into winter, with the late rains, I think that it's prompted a lot of the birds of this area to nest a bit later than they would normally. I was looking for those giraffe. Oh, sorry, while I was looking for those waxbills, I've lost my giraffe. Oh, there we go. I just wanted one last look, just to agree with James Richards' point about how awkward and yet graceful they are. I would like to think that I coordinate myself in a similar manner, but I think that might be giving myself a bit too much credit. I think I'm just a bit awkward and clumsy. But they do have a very interesting stride. The other thing that amazes me on the way that they, or the way that they move, is the speed at which they can, and the distance that they can cover. You don't realize it because they look like they're moving so slowly, but I guess when your legs are 2 meters long, 6 feet long, a long stride is not a difficult thing. It must be walking next to a giraffe, I think, is very similar to walking next to Brent, who tends to forget how long, just how long his legs really are. But they do cover immense amounts of ground, and they walk uniquely out of all of the animals here, like a camel, with both feet on the right side and then both feet on the left side moving together. Maybe that's also what to us, even though we don't realize that we are noticing that difference, maybe that's what gives us a little bit about, a little bit of a feeling of awkwardness or ungainliness. And of course, that also means that they can't trot like a zebra can trot. They have to either walk or gallop. And that gallop is a very smooth, very loping stride that just eats up the ground. It's incredible to witness. And I've done a couple of giraffe captures where a giraffe's been darted in order to move it to a different area. And trying to catch up with even a darted giraffe to try and catch it and make sure that it doesn't fall and hurt itself is very interesting. All right, well, we've come to the end of our sunrise safari. I didn't manage to find Karula, but nevertheless, we found other wonderful, magical things. Thank you, VM, for your camera work and for your wonderful spotting skills. And thank you to all of you as the viewers for your questions and your comments. As I said earlier, it means a great deal to us. Have a fantastic day wherever you are in the world, and we're going to finish off the sunrise safari with Brent and some pachyderms.
So isn't this awesome? Just before the end of the sunrise safari, we've come across a really big herd of elephants. There's probably about 30 in total around us. And slowly moving through. Look at that, quite a few youngsters here, some as young as a month or two, but others reaching all the way through. We've got all spectrums of ages here. And boys and girls. So they're moving. We're going to reverse back, try and see where they're going. But there's one sort of group of them right here, and then there's another sort of 15 or 20 behind. And there's a couple on the other side of the road as well. Can't see them now. A beautiful, lovely, big, relaxed herd. Oh, yes, sorry. Little boy giving us a trumpet as we move backwards. Do seem to be on a mission. They're not stopping and feeding, but keeping going. And this could be fun. We've got a really big herd of kudu behind us, and with lots of little elephant bulls, they like to chase things. So will they chase the poor kudu? And here the kudu are. Hello, kudus. Quite pretty in between the silver cluster leaves. Oh, those eddies look like they've changed direction, unfortunately. Moving away from the kudu. I was really hoping they might, one of those young boys might decide to chase the kudu. Here we go. There's those other elephants. It looks like a female and a youngster. Out in the open on this wonderful big, oh, there goes that fluffy white tail, and this wonderful big open area. This is going to be quite a spectacular shot. Get ready to take some screenshots. She's going to walk in front with that whole valley heading down towards the more washy river behind her. There she is, with miles and miles of Africa. Look at her go, big female. And you can see her teats are enlarged, so she is lactating, and we're about to have a scrambling little baby who's been left behind slightly. And there he is. You can see tail's a little bit erect, he's a little bit nervous. Where's my mom gone? Now he's seen her and knows where she is, so back to being relaxed. So the hillies are really taking advantage of all this grass while it's here. And they're not going to be able to utilize it for too long into the dry season. Oh, itchy ear. Quite nice to just have a peaceful moment sitting here looking over the vast expanse that's in front of us. And isn't it incredible that we're in our vast expanse we can put some elephants? And they're about to move off into the thickets. The little one already has, she's about to join. So, as the elephants disappear, I've noticed some flower species that we're going to have to get to on the sunset safari. I haven't seen them yet. Two very spectacular flowers. So you're going to have to wait and join us for the sunset safari if you want to see those interesting flower species. And hopefully the cats stop evading us. But I've had a thoroughly wonderful time with you guys on the back of the vehicle. Thanks for all your questions. And it is a privilege to be able to share our love and passion for Africa with you. So as the elephants disappear, we're about to do the same. And I'm gonna ask Jean-André to show you one flower quickly for the last few seconds as we say goodbye. We'll have a closer look at it. But that is a wild foxglove. Some of the you might have that in your garden. But to find out more about the foxglove, join us on the Sunset Safari. So cheers for now from Jandre and myself.